All right, I'd like to welcome you all to this webinar today on why are human rights considerations fundamental to social protection responses to COVID-19. We'd like to thank you all for joining us from wherever you are in the world. We've got really exciting set of panelists today who are going to come at this issue from different directions and from different parts of the planet. So we hope it's going to be an exciting discussion. I'm Shay McClanahan. I'm a senior social policy specialist at Development Pathways. I'll be the moderator. Just quickly, we're going to go over some housekeeping before we actually turn to the interventions, some logistics, introducing panelists, and the format that we'll follow today. And then I'll give just a couple of minutes to present some of the motivation behind the panel before handing over to our panelists. Just to note that this is the 22nd webinar in the series on socialprotection.org on social protection responses to COVID-19. That's pretty impressive, and that tells us how long some of us have been in quarantine and in lockdown for us to be on number 22. This series is a joint effort. It's initiated by the IPC, the International Policy Center for Inclusive Growth in Brazil, on behalf of BMZ and DFAT, and in collaboration with socialprotection.org platform and other partners from other organizations. The webinar series is part of an initiative that has two components, and one is a collaborative mapping of country responses, so news and documents, and this is disseminated, many of you may have seen this, weekly through a dedicated newsletter on COVID responses. And then the second component is an online community on socialprotection.org that covers this topic that you can, to foster discussion, and all of you can join that, and there will be links provided later on for you to follow, and we really encourage you to do that. I just want to mention that the next webinar, so you can all get out your calendars to plan, in this series will be on Tuesday, July 21st, excuse me, and it will focus on the continuity and preparedness of school feeding programs under COVID-19. So please, all of you, register for that, and there are several others listed there as well, which will be available for you, and we encourage you to look them up. Now, turning to our panelists, I'm going to introduce them briefly. You will have their full bios, so I'm just going to give a couple of lines on them. We have a truly global panel today that we're bringing together with a wealth of experience on these issues, both on social protection and on human rights and economic and social justice in general. First, we'll have Abdul Alim, who's social policy advisor at UNICEF South Asia. He's currently based in Kathmandu. He's been working with UNICEF for the last couple of decades, covering lots of different regions, South Asia, Southeast Asia, Central and Eastern Europe, and the CIS countries, as well as the Middle East. Comes at this from a results-based management, but also human rights focus, and working on social protection for many, many years. Also, we have Alexandra Barrantes, who's senior social policy specialist, my colleague at Development Pathways. She's also got a wealth of experience in these issues, focusing on social protection, poverty reduction, inequality, also economic and social and cultural rights. So really comes from a strong background of promoting human rights and the human rights-based approach to social protection. And we're looking forward to her presentation. And finally, we have Simone Cecchini, who's the Senior Social Affairs Officer at ECLAC in Santiago in Chile. And he's been based there for many years as well and focuses on social protection, on design, but also on equality and human rights. All three of these panelists are going to have come from different angles and from different disciplinary backgrounds and different parts of the globe. But I think we're coming with a common message. So I think that's what we're going to see today from each of their interventions. As far as the format for the webinar, I'm just going to take, this is my 5 minutes, getting through it quickly. First, then we'll move to Alim, who will speak. Each of the speakers will have 15 minutes. So we'll start with Alim, then we'll move to Alexandra, and then we'll finish with Simone. And after that, we'll give the panelists themselves about 10 minutes to have a discussion among themselves. And I might ask them some questions as well. And following that, we'll really leave some time for all of you to ask questions to the panelists that they can answer. We encourage you throughout the presentations to please send your questions. You'll see that there's a questions tab on your app. So please record your questions in that app, and they will then be collated throughout the presentations by the colleagues at socialprotection.org. And then we'll be able to go through them during the Q&A. And we hope to get through all of them. If we can't, there will be, again, a collection of them posted later in the community. If you join the Social Protection Responses to COVID online community, you can participate in some of those follow-ups after the webinar. Just on, very briefly, on the context and motivation behind this webinar. I think there's been a sense in general that we've been drifting away over the last 20 years from what had been becoming a strong discourse in human rights, placing human rights at the center, not necessarily of social protection but of development. And this has been slow. We've been drifting away from this in favor of what might be called more technical debates, more attention on growth, on fiscal space, on technical design issues in social policy, maybe a narrower focus on poverty reduction, on incentives, on conditions, on graduation, and so paying less attention to rights as a fundamental issue. So I want us to think about this word fundamental that is strategically placed in the title of today's webinar. Why are human rights considerations fundamental to social protection responses to COVID? So this session attempts to really shift that focus back onto rights, the idea of rights as being fundamental or first in the way that we think about these responses. So how does this pandemic force us to grapple with issues that maybe we've been ignoring, maybe we've been overlooking, maybe we've been under-prioritizing. Maybe it was easier to look the other way in context of high growth when poverty was going down. There was maybe an assumption that rights are either being respected or that maybe it's someone else's job. That's something that we leave to the courts. It's a technical issue that's resolved in this other space. It's not resolved in the design space or in the systems space. So we really want to bring that back to the center in this discussion. And many people, but including our panelists, have long been critical of this sort of laissez-faire approach to human rights as an extra, as an add-on. And I think that will come out in these presentations. So now we have COVID. Now we have COVID-19 in our lives. And this is the worst health and economic crisis that any of us has seen in our lifetimes. What does it mean? So the implications we're really only beginning to understand. And today, I think what we're going to ask or try to ask of the panelists is, how did this situation bring rights back to the agenda? In what way? How are we seeing it come back on the agenda? What gaps does COVID reveal in our previous approach, in our conventional way of doing things in social protection? So how has it laid bare some of the weaknesses in that conventional approach? And then what are the implications of doing this for the way that we approach designing and implementing? So not just designing, but also implementing social protection, both now as a response to the crisis, but also beyond. What kinds of systems are we developing that might be more resilient systems in the future? What are countries actually doing? And then how do human rights considerations come into the mix when they're doing the policy planning? What do the discussions look like? And these, a lot of our panelists are on the ground with countries in active discussions about these responses that we're getting weekly updates about. So they're gonna be able to tell us a bit more about how those conversations are happening. And then finally, what is the way forward? So we're gonna unpack some of those things today with our panelists. And so without further ado, you don't want to hear from me, I'm going to turn over to Abdul Alim. Alim, we'll turn over to you and you'll start us off today.
Okay, thank you, Shri, very much. That was a very comprehensive introduction of what is going to happen today. My take on the relationship between human rights, COVID, and what is happening in South Asia is a bit of political history of South Asia and how the state has evolved in South Asia. And I believe that we have had some what I call a maldevelopment in South Asian state development, which has now been exposed because of the COVID crisis. So I don't think that the issues that we see today in terms of the crisis have specifically to do with COVID. There was a crisis brewing in terms of how the state and the nature of state development in South Asia has been shaping. And COVID has just accelerated some of the fault lines and the crises that we see in state formation in South Asia. And so I believe that if we look at this from the perspective of social contract, it would probably be helpful to do an analysis that points us to what I call more sustainable solutions to how to even deal with COVID, but also look at this in a long-term perspective. Now, my fellow speakers will speak much more in detail about human rights, the universality, the inalienability, interdependency, and indivisibility of them, equality and non-discrimination. And I'm quite sure that some of you are already familiar with those notions. So I'll just try and focus on what I believe are the key determinants of what is happening in South Asia as a region, and why is this relevant to the violation of rights. Now, we know that the social contract is sort of an unwritten contract between citizens and the state, where citizens have rights and duties, and governments have rights and obligations. I'm not quite sure if we can talk about governmental rights, but certainly the governments have obligations. And if you see the figure on your screen, you will see that there is a sort of a cycle that is created between citizens and the government, where citizens create and contribute to the nation through financial means, of course, taxes and public services. The government then in return meets its obligations to provide social security, which is also a UN recognized human right. And therefore, the two parties fulfill a social contract. And it is critical for both parties to do their job for that harmony and trust relationship to establish between these two important parts of state formation. But what has happened in South Asia is that many of you will know that South Asia has been in what I call a low development equilibrium, or a vicious cycle of low revenue, low social investment, and development of low human capital. Now, this is a sort of vicious cycle where low human capital leads to low revenues and therefore low social investment, and the cycle continues. And the result of this over the last 75 years in South Asia has been that the state has been losing its legitimacy, and its trustworthiness has eroded, along with what I call a democratic deficit. So we have had regular elections in South Asia, and of course, large countries like India, Pakistan, Bangladesh have always had elections. But yet we still have a problem with what I call representational problems in the nature of dialogue we have. And I think that has to do with the fact that South Asia is not nation states, these are state nations. That's a fundamental difference between how states got formed in Europe, where the word nation state actually takes origin from. And these state nations that were formed in South Asia when the British left with and drew boundaries while they were leaving, and left nations in South Asia to decide for themselves how would they like to become a state. So it is very much work in progress, but it has not been producing the kind of fulfillment, and the state obligations have not been met. And therefore, there is a gradual erosion of state capacity. And these can be really easily understood if you look at the low levels of human social investments in South Asia. And just to give you some figures, the investment in health sector across many countries in South Asia has been less than 1% of GDP over the last 1.5 decades. Now that's really, really low, because many countries have actually not even gone above 0.8% allocation. And expenditures are even further low, because out of that 0.8% of GDP allocation, 50% usually is returned to the treasury. So actual expenditures are even further low. And now the situation has reached to a point where in South Asia, 60 to 65% of the health expenditure actually comes out of pocket of people who seek healthcare. So in Pakistan, for instance, out of the 4% or 5% of GDP that is spent on health, 3 to 4% of GDP actually comes from private sector contributions, and only less than 1% comes from the government. Same is the case in education, and similar figures are for India. In Bangladesh, similar figures are for education, where almost half of the contribution of GDP in terms of percentage comes from private sector in Pakistan. And revenues across South Asia are very, very low. The best national performance on tax to GDP is essentially Nepal, which is doing about 17%. But Bangladesh, India, and Pakistan are locked somewhere between 13 to 15% of GDP as revenue ratios. And they are very, very low in terms of sustaining state capacity to be able to go back and invest in social sectors. At that low level, it is even difficult to fully do debt servicing, which is another source, source of drain on national resources. So what is really happening is that these right violations are eroding the state capacity to perform its functions, and these manifest themselves in high rates of both monetary and multidimensional poverty, affecting children the most, and of course the adolescents the most, and with a very high demographic ratio of young people we have in South Asia, that's a huge loss to the future productivity of our nations. There is a very high level of informalization of economy, which is about 70 to 75%. That just tells you that people don't want to come in any contact with the state and want to remain out of touch with any state institutions. They don't want to be documented. There is a huge amount of migration of labor out of South Asia, and several countries in South Asia, including Nepal, for instance, have almost 30% of their GDP that comes from remittances from outside. And this, of course, leads to and has persisted in a sort of what we call elite capture, a sort of a remnant of an extractive economy that was inherited by the British in South Asia, and has remained so for almost 70 years now, and a persistent, in fact, and rising inequality in South Asia. Now, this is not to say that things have not improved. Of course, poverty has decreased and many mortality indicators have improved, but I think the overall situation remains unsustainable because of this low level of trust between citizens and the state, and the fact that people are not fully participating in building their own states. So the question is, what do you do actually to break this vicious cycle? Rights have been violated. Rights have been violated in the sense of the people not having health for health benefits. Education is not being given to children. They are not being protected. So almost in every sphere, there is a violation of rights, including low investments in social protection systems. And one of the most important aspects of what I believe is a problem is we have very fragmented, poorly targeted discriminatory social protection systems, where we have schemes or interventions that have very high exclusion errors and conditionalities, which are stigmatizing and often lead to social problems. So there's a real need now in the context of COVID, when we know that the governments have actually mobilized a huge amount of resources. Many governments in South Asia have actually mobilized almost 10% of their GDP to provide fiscal stimulus to many sectors in their economies. But unfortunately, even now, the percentage of GDP that goes to direct household support, where the state needs to build its trust, has been really, really dismal in the sense of 0.8% of GDP in many countries has gone to household direct household support. So I believe that unless there is a clear direction in terms of understanding that that rights are not subject to fiscal limitations and the rights have to be met at all costs, there is not going to be any improvement in the kind of social contract we have in South Asia. And now is the time to really look at this in depth and try and restore it through what I call, and what UNICEF really promotes, is life cycle inclusive social protection systems. And we must start with children, who form largest part of the poor group in the households, because they are large number of children in every household. And therefore, it is important for not only building sustainable future for South Asian countries to start investing in children by starting schemes like universal child benefits, which can be actually achieved at moderate costs to percentage, or at sort of moderate cost to GDP. We have calculated that it takes about 1.5% to 2% of GDP to start a universal benefit, child benefit scheme in many countries in South Asia. And it is doable given the current context. And I think it's high time to do it now, because if you don't do it now, and if the current situation of low trust continues and the social contract is not renewed, then we will continue this vicious cycle, and COVID is just going to undo state integrity and legitimacy as in terms of more acceleration. And therefore, it is important to now pay attention to this in the context of meeting and fulfilling rights and restoring social contract in South Asia. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Aleem. We've got a few more minutes, so I think I might just ask you one question as a follow-up before we turn to Alex. I appreciated the social contract description and the virtuous versus vicious cycle. And it does sometimes feel that social protection has become so residualized that we're in a self-fulfilling sort of cycle, where low investment inevitably leads to less power for social protection to actually make a difference, not just to people's lives who are receiving the benefits where transfers are small, but also at the aggregate in economies. And I guess I would just ask, so you made the suggestion of child benefits, and I think that's also going to be a common theme throughout today's webinar, but I wonder if you can talk a bit more about some of the best performers in South Asia, or or where you see the most potential for that taking hold, and if you can talk about that in the context of the actual approaches that the governments in South Asia have been taking in response to COVID. So what has been the dominant, what's been the nature of their responses in the region? Has it been mostly focused on employment, job retention schemes, employment generation? Where has it taken us, and where do child benefits fit in that agenda?
Yeah, I think you've touched a very sensitive issue. We are still trying to gather the kind of what I call the political threshold in policymaking process in many countries in South Asia to try and get policymakers' attention to this very, very critical intervention that can actually help the governments to even raise revenues in the long term, provide a multiplier, sort of economic multiplier effect to local markets, provide disposable income to households so that the demand side of the economy can pick up. Now, when we make, the usual come back to that argument is that we don't have any fiscal space. And I think for now, I can quote at least three examples in South Asia, which are, of course, still under development. We still don't know exactly how they're going to pan out, because even in these countries, governments have overwhelmingly voted in favor of giving much more help to the corporates and job security and other bailouts. But Nepal stands out as a very strange outlier in South Asia, in the sense that Nepal has been spending almost 4% of its GDP on social protection, and it is not a coincidence that Nepal actually also has one of the highest tax to GDP ratios. And I don't think this is a coincidence, because of course I can't really give you empirical evidence that there is a linkage between 4% of GDP to social protection and 17 to 18% of the highest level of tax to GDP ratios. But my hunch says that there is a relationship between citizens' trusts and why citizens would want to give tax to the government if children in their households are being covered in terms of universal benefits. So UNICEF has been working in Nepal for a while now. And in 2015, when the earthquake happened, we took the opportunity to actually advocate with the government to start universalizing child benefits even then. And the government has moved carefully, but they are improving their coverage, and the argument has made sense to the government. And I believe that Nepal would perhaps be one of the first states to go ahead and do the universal child benefit work, and it will immensely help their tax to GDP ratios. Sri Lanka comes to my mind next, and there is a huge debate going on right now in the government on universal child benefits. At this point in time, I think the Sri Lankan government is undergoing to go through elections in the next couple of months. So I think that there may be a bit of a lapse in policymakers' attention, but I think that eventually we will get there in Sri Lanka too, because Sri Lanka has a very good history of investing in these areas. Of course, in terms of COVID response, Kerala stands out in terms of its extremely successful response to COVID. And it doesn't take any intelligence to understand that Kerala has been an outstanding social development model in South Asia in general. And their expenditures, social expenditures, have been among the highest in the world, even in 50s and 60s and 70s. So they are doing they have done the best in terms of COVID response because of the fact that they had built a very solid social capital and a solid state contract between citizens and the state. Over.
Thank you. I think we'll turn over to Alexandra if her presentation is loaded. There we go. Over to you, Alex.
Thank you. Thank you, Shay. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all of you joining us from different parts of the world, as Shay was mentioning. The idea of my presentation today is to just briefly go over what I would like to call practical considerations for taking into consideration human rights principles and standards for both the design and the implementation of social protection policies, in particular within the midst of COVID-19. So, many times in this field, I've encountered questions around the practicality or the practical approach towards social protection, and how can you incorporate some of these standards? So I'm going to try and go into some of the practical issues as well. And just like Aleem was going over in the case of Southeast Asia, I think there are very practical examples of some of the avenues that countries are trying to follow within the midst of the pandemic in terms of human rights considerations. So before I go into the actual presentation, I also wanted to remind, if you haven't seen it, only last week, Philip Alston, the former UN Rapporteur on Extreme Poverty and Human Rights, launched his latest report on poverty and the situation of poverty measurement around the world. And one of the issues that was brought to the attention in that report is the plight of at least 4 million people, around 4 million people, with no minimum benefits, with no minimum coverage in terms of social protection. And one of the reasons that he provides in his report is exactly because of the lack of a normative foundation to some of the policies that are being put forward in social protection, not necessarily for COVID-19, but that only worsens the situation. It is mainly touches upon the fact that governments are not necessarily relating social protection to the existing international normative framework that phrases international in international development and in human rights in general, and relating the social protection efforts that our governments are pushing forward with the right to social security, social protection. And I think ultimately this is also in this report considered as a policy option, right? Instead of having it just as a policy, as another policy option, human rights, and this is what I think we're trying to achieve with this webinar as well, is making the case for human rights considerations to actually be not only one of the policy options, but hopefully the considerations and standards that you put into place into all of the policies, and in particular social protection that we're discussing today. So those are some of the key messages that I will be discussing during this presentation. So next, sorry, I'm having to, okay. So what does, if we had to give just a few oversights in terms of what a human rights standard or what a human rights approach brings to social protection, it is framing social policy, social protection debates around entitlements and not handouts or benefits or charity, right? That's a key distinction, and that's a key element of what human rights bring into the social protection world. Again, as we will see in the next few slides, social protection as a right, social security as a right, is enshrined in universal and also regional human rights instruments and different rights systems, and they are hence legally binding for governments that have signed those treaties and those conventions. And they obviously require an adequate legal and institutional framework to be brought upon at the national level to be able to continue and to be able to guarantee those rights at the national level. It also makes a change and a distinction, and that links to what Aline was presenting in terms of the social contract with regards to state duty, state being the duty bearer and individuals being right holders instead of just being at the passive role of receiving benefits from the state at the receiving end. And it makes right holders as agents of change, and that's a general context for international development, obviously, as well, in terms of the rights-based approach. And also there is an important distinction or an important reminder with regards to the fact that human rights are interdependent. So we have to link the right to social security, to social protection, with other rights, and that is something that is very much at the core of a rights-based approach. And then finally, one key consideration is also the fact that poverty is not or should not be seen as something that is, it's not inevitable, right? In many cases, and as I was mentioning the former UN rapporteur's report and much of the work that has been done, poverty is ultimately a policy choice in the sense that if we don't choose to go ahead with policies that effectively reduce poverty, that effectively reduce inequality, and that have human rights considerations at the very core. So next slide, please. Next slide. Oh, sorry. Yeah, no, that's fine. So I'm not going to go into this into very much detail. I'm hoping that some of the participants of this webinar have heard about a rights-based approach to social protection before and are familiar at least a little bit in terms of the international and regional framework and in terms of enshrining the right to social security, to social protection within international instruments and conventions. So we have a very wide range of examples and different places where you can actually see this, but it's the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights in the case of the universal system. There's also in the case of Latin America, the Protocolo San Salvador, which is also at the regional level on economic, social and cultural rights. We also have, if you can go to the next slide, please, the Convention of the Rights of the Child. We've got the Social Protection Floor Recommendation from the ILO, number 202. We have the SDGs, and even though they're not a legally binding document in terms of a convention and a rights-based approach, they do incorporate quite a few elements that we will discuss later on in terms of that are key to the rights-based approach to social security. And as such, we'll go to the next slide. Many of these, as I was mentioning, many of these international human rights frameworks are also enshrined or some way captivated into the national constitutions, because as they are legally binding, they also in many cases given a constitutional status in some of the countries that we're going to be discussing today. One element that I just wanted to also point out is that dignity is at the very core of the human rights-based approach in all of the different aspects. And the fact that this is so is also one of the key attributes and another key advantages of bringing in a rights-based approach, in the sense that if we think ultimately public policies, and in particular social protection policies, should be holding this to the core of what they're doing in terms of the design and the implementation, in terms of the dignity of human beings. Next slide, please. Sorry, I'm not controlling the slides themselves. So we could have a whole day discussing a rights-based approach to social protection, and in particular how it pertains to the current situation of COVID-19 and pandemics in general. But I've chosen to focus this presentation on five different aspects that human rights considerations or a human rights approach can bring to the responses to social protection within the current framework of COVID-19. And I've chosen those five to try and summarize some of the more practical approaches as well, in terms of how or what should be looking at. If you're a policymaker somewhere in the world, if you are an official working for an international agency, what are some of the key considerations? So beyond the very obvious fact that, as I was mentioning before, the right to social security and the right to social protection is a human right, and that is legally binding to those states that have actually signed up, that have also this state obligation. Unfortunately, sometimes the legal framework per se, just on its own, is not enough. And that's a very sad piece of news, but that is the way it is. So some of the key additional considerations that I would say are that human rights provide guiding principles and standards to the policy design and implementation, and also the monitoring of some of these policies, that it brings a life cycle perspective to social protection, that it also promotes inclusivity in social protection policies, that it actually is a shock responsive. If you have a human rights-based approach to social protection, it brings in a shock responsiveness aspect that we'll be looking into more detail. And that finally, we also need to remember that it's not only about the policy outcomes in terms of poverty reduction, closing the intergenerational transmission of poverty and inequality amongst generations and what have you. It's also about the process. It's not only outcomes, it's also the process. And if you can go to the next slide, I'll start going into each one of these in a little bit more of a detail. Next slide, please. So the first one, as I was saying, is one of the key aspects of a rights-based approach to social protection is that it brings in existing standards and principles from the human rights a normative framework that can be brought into, from a very practical standpoint, into the policy making arena. If you can go to the next slide. The idea is that these different principles and standards from human rights can actually be used on a very practical level for policymakers, designers, and the implementation of these policies. Some of those include equality and non-discrimination, accessibility, adaptability, adequacy of the benefit, participation, accountability, right to privacy, dignity, and autonomy of individuals. And as I was saying, dignity being at the very core. One example, for example, on a very practical term, is one of the most used mechanisms in trying to address COVID-19 for social protection systems has been the management information systems, for example. What kind of instruments do countries have in place, existing instruments, in terms of the management of beneficiaries of these programs? So one of the key aspects is to remember that these principles should be applied into the design, but also into the implementation. So how are, for example, management information systems throughout the world that are the backbone of some of the social protection schemes, how are they incorporating issues around right to privacy? How are they incorporating issues around dignity, around participation and accountability, for example? So that's a very practical example of how some of these principles and standards should be implemented and should be used on a daily basis and incorporated into these policies. But that's a very practical approach. There's other aspects as well, of course, but hopefully we can address some of them during the questions, as I don't want to go too much on this. Next slide, please. Number two, and the next slide, is the fact that a rights-based approach helps us look at it, look at the solution, look at the response from a life cycle perspective. This image is just to show, I mean, who does COVID-19 affect? Who does it put at risk? Is it just a few people? It's just the poorest of the poor, the richest, the middle segments? Who is it that it affects? And unfortunately, even though the most marginalized segments of society are the ones hardest hit for obvious reasons, because of social distancing, because of loss of jobs and what have you, ultimately it is everybody in, and that's why we're all in lockdown. I'm here in lockdown in my in-laws' house right now at this stage in Colombia. Many of us, all of us in different parts of the world, are currently experiencing lockdown. Next slide, please. So ultimately the idea from a life cycle perspective is that individual of all ages are both right holders in the sense that they have a right to social protection, but they are also vulnerable to shocks and risk across the life cycle. And this is something that those of us who support a life cycle and inclusive social protection policies for quite a few years, this is one of the key arguments that we've been trying to push forward for a really long time. And I think in situations such as COVID-19, this is even shown more explicitly, right? It is not only a life cycle approach in social protection implies that we would have benefits and different allowances throughout the life cycle, from child to working age, to old age, and also in terms of disability, which might impact somebody across in any stage of their life, right? And again, human rights standards and principles, as I was mentioning in the previous section on the number one, are also something that need to be embedded into all of these. I mean, and again, so the idea, basic idea, is we're all right holders and we are all vulnerable to shocks and risks. And in particular, in the midst of COVID-19, that particularly holds true, unfortunately. Next slide, please. So the third issue that I wanted to bring into the discussion is the issue around inclusivity. And next slide, please. And the core idea in terms of the inclusivity is looking at social protection from two different, and this is again, this is a generalization, it's not black and white, it's just the way to sort of systematize or to sort of simplify two different approaches on social protection. One of them is related to what Aline was talking about in terms of the social contract, and it's about a human rights or citizenship approach in which social protection is for all, depending, I mean, as you see from a life cycle perspective, and it's based on principle of solidarity and entitlements, versus another approach, which is the charity approach or the poor relief approach, which is for the others. It is social protection just for the others, for those deserving the social protection services and programs. And this is based on unequal relationship and on this concept of the deserving poor. If you can go to the next slide, please. So the idea behind this is on the deserving, unfortunately, the deservingness concept around social protection is very much embedded into the social protection discourse, has been for a really long time, but it's really in cases of the pandemic, such as the COVID-19, that it comes to all of our minds in the fact that, can we really base our social protection responses on this idea of the others and deservingness of the others when it is all of us who might be at risk to vulnerable situations, and in particular COVID-19. So this is something that I also wanted to point out in terms of this, the approach to a rights-based approach. And again, it's, we're all unfortunately on the same, in the same boat. So who is actually the deserving person or the deserving segment of society that should be getting social protection? Isn't all of us? Shouldn't we all be getting social protection benefits? Next slide, please. Shay has mentioned that I'm running out of time, so I'll try and speed up a little bit. So again, I'm just going to go over some of the, and we can discuss this a little bit more in the questions section. The idea is that some of the non sort of social protection human rights approach responses to COVID-19 would incorporate, including was sort of continuing incorporating conditions and sanctions, this issues around negative poverty narratives and others and deservingness, right? That's a no-no in terms of a rights-based approach to social protection. If you can go to the next slide, please. And then shock responsiveness, next slide. The idea as well in this is that the inclusive nature of more universal life cycle schemes is that they also obviously have a larger coverage in those ages, in those categorical ages, and that they are hence more effective in terms of response to widespread shocks, and in particular COVID-19. And again, the best shock responsive social protection programs are the ones that are strengthening, that are based on the core social protection systems existing in a country. And that we should look into life cycle systems that guarantee citizens regular and predictable income transfers. And that's the basic shock responsiveness, right? It is looking at inclusive social protection schemes and investing more in social protection so that those, because those have the most responsive. And I think both Ali mentioned about universal child benefits, and hopefully Simone will also go into some examples in Latin America on this. Next slide, please. And then ultimately, the last one is that it's also, the next slide, it's also about the process and not just policy outcomes. This is a key, next slide, please. This is a key concept in a rights-based approach, and it should also be a very practical approach. One example is relates back to the issue around inclusivity. It's about poverty targeting, right? The effectiveness of poverty targeted has been questioned by several reports. There's more information on that. And that policies based on human rights focus their importance on all the process in terms of the implementation, the design, the participation, how is it implemented? It's not just focusing on the outcomes. And I think for the pandemic, it is particularly important to bear this in mind. And as somebody such as Martin Revalian, who's been in the international social protection world and poverty reduction world for quite some time now, I've quoted him here, this is no time to be worrying about targeting the poor. Fine targeting in poor places is overrated in normal times. Now it makes little sense. And this is in the midst of the COVID-19. So I also want to remind ourselves that sometimes we need to look at this, and this is a very perfect example of how some of the social protection instruments that have been implemented in past are just no way, next slide please, to address some of the, and there was an image here, is there? Okay, so yeah, anyways, so the I'll just finish by here saying that the focus needs to be on inclusive social protection systems instead of just focusing on the deserving. I think the pandemic has shown once more that we are all at risk to vulnerabilities across our life cycles and pandemics such as this one. We should avoid, and this is a very practical recommendation as well, in terms of we should avoid fragmentation of system delivery. One of the things that when you look at social protection responses to COVID-19 is that many times what we're doing is we're adding on different cash transfers or different programs for the poor, for the informal workers, for different segments of society, instead of looking at this as an opportunity to rethink the way that we've approached social protection as a whole, and to really make sure that we're looking forward in terms of addressing and also investing in more inclusive social protection systems that address these risks and vulnerabilities across the life cycle, and also address issues around pandemics. So again, the idea is to strengthen the national core social protection systems, and that make sure, because these are the most effective ones as well, that guarantee citizens of all ages access to social protection. And this becomes very much true in times of COVID-19. And the next slide, and I'm done, is again just a reminder that unfortunately old ways won't open the doors, and maybe this is the time to rethink the way that we approach social protection. And then the last slide, if you can change it, has some links to some of the work that we have been doing with some partners, including UNICEF, and hopefully these will be shared with you after the webinar is finalized. Thank you very much. Back to you, Shay.
All right, thank you, Alex. I think I'll leave my questions and comments until the end, and we'll turn straight to Simone. So we'll let you load your slides.
Yes, and hello.
Over to you. There you go.
Thanks, Shay. It's a pleasure to be sharing this webinar with you, with Alim, with Alexandra, and all of you who are online. I'm talking from Chile, one of the Latin American countries hardest hit by this pandemic. And basically, the fact that Latin America and the Caribbean is one of the global hotspots of the coronavirus pandemic in terms of contagion, in terms of death, is explained a lot by inequality, informality, and the weakness of social protection. If we consider a human rights approach, it is something fundamental both to understand what is going on and also to understand and to propose a better policies. Here in the slides that I'm sharing, first of all, a consideration very much in line with what Alexandra was saying, that there are some key principles, some key elements of the human rights approach that makes it possible to design better policies. The rights-based approach does not prescribe exactly what the social protection policies and how they are designed and implemented, but it does offer direction. And these principles are obviously equality and non-discrimination, progressiveness and non-regressiveness, the use of maximum available resources, comprehensiveness, legal and institutional framework, participation, transparency and access to information and accountability. Philosophically, I would say, following the philosopher Norberto Bobbio, that the rationale behind economic and social rights is indeed to reduce inequalities between the haves and the have-nots, and to place a growing number of people on a better footing compared with those who are better off. Coming to Latin America and the Caribbean, on the world stage, we are a middle-income region. We are about, in terms of GDP per capita, as you can see on the left-hand side, about 6 times richer than Sub-Saharan Africa. And in turn, North America is about 6 times richer than Latin America and the Caribbean. But that average product, that average per capita income is not shared very evenly. And actually, it's shared very unequally. And here you see, in dollars terms, the incomes of different social strata, and in the dots you can see the percentage of the population belonging to those strata. And as you can see, most about 3/4 of the Latin American and Caribbean population belongs either to low income or to lower middle income strata, which means that this is population that is either poor, extremely poor, or very vulnerable to a crisis such as the one that we are living. So coronavirus came to Latin America. It came from other regions, from those who traveled, say, to Europe, and it came first into urban areas that were richer and where people had better health conditions. And then we saw the virus spreading to poorer, more dense, low-income areas, more economically vulnerable, with worse access to health services. And then we saw very adverse economic and social consequences, especially for the poor and informal workers, which include, say, especially women, young people, indigenous and Afro-descendants and migrants, and people who were not and who are not able to generate income and who lack savings to face the crisis. And not only has been the socioeconomic impacts tougher on this population group, but also the health impact. Very often informal workers still, even at times of quarantine, they have to get out to survive, to generate some sort of income. And so the risk of infection is higher for the poor and for the vulnerable. And they are even at greater risk of death for pre-existing health conditions or because they lack health care. So what we use at the Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean to examine what is going on in society is what we call the social inequality matrix. Basically, we see different population groups under the lens of equality and non-discrimination, Obviously, first of all, we look at gender equality, we look at the problems faced by informal workers, female paid domestic workers, by low and lower middle income strata, but also we look at discrimination among specific groups along the life cycle, or because of racism, or because of migration. And then we look at the, in a comprehensive way, at the different areas that are affected by the pandemic, obviously health, but also nutrition, education, labor incomes, child labor, which is increasing, access to basic services, unpaid care, intrafamily violence. So a human rights approach gives this comprehensive view and also brings to the table some issues like, say, the fact that care, unpaid domestic care, is so important in this stage where there are quarantines, where there are sick people, etc. And also we see problems like violence against women and adolescent girls. So what is the picture in terms of poverty in Latin America? Well, at the ECLAC, we are doing some projections for this year, for 2020, and in economic terms, they are really dramatic. We are witnessing the worst economic recession in recorded history, even worse than the debt crisis or the financial crisis of 2008-2009. We're projecting a GDP of minus 9.1% rate, right, in this 2020, which implies that unemployment is going to raise to 13.5%. And also we're projecting an increase in income inequality because those who are worst affected are indeed the informal workers, lower income workers. So we, depending on the countries, the Gini coefficients will increase between 1% and 8%. All of these will cause poverty at the regional level to go up to 37.3%, which means 231 million people, and extreme poverty to 15.5%, which is 96 million people. Extreme poverty is not just a statistic, right? The way we measure it means that 15.5% of the Latin American Caribbean population will not even have the income resources necessary to acquire to buy a basic income food basket. So this is really dramatic. Also, as I was saying, we need to look, and I share this vision with what I mentioned by Alexandra, obviously focus on the extreme poor, the poor, but also look at those broad and vulnerable strata of the population that, for instance, in Latin America in 2019, about 470 million people were living with incomes up to three times the poverty line. This is increasing to 490 million people, 79% of the population. And we observe that middle income strata, their living conditions are worsening. And these are groups of the population that, as I was saying, don't have enough savings to weather a crisis. So this message is important in terms of social policies that need to be more universal, broader necessarily, to guarantee basic necessity and guarantee consumption for broad strata of the population. Governments have acted. We have been observing since mid-March in Latin America a lot of measures being taken. We have classified them in five different areas. The first two belong to what we call non-contributory social protection, for instance, cash transfers, which can be new programs or the expansion of existing programs in terms of the amounts of the benefits or population coverage, also in some instances, early disbursement, and also in-kind transfers, mostly food transfers. Together, we have observed 190 measures in 30 countries, reaching about 60 million households, 289 million people, 44% of the region's population, at the cost of about $67 billion, 1.4% of GDP. Also, we have observed countries guaranteeing basic services. In lockdown, you need to guarantee that people have access to electricity, water, sanitation, so not cutting those services, telephone, internet as well. Also, clearly important measures in terms of social protection for formal workers, not only in terms of teleworking, but also in protecting income and employment, where unemployment insurance exists, also leave and bans on dismissal, and finally other measures to protect individual and families, like price control of food in some countries, tax reliefs, and loan and mortgages. However, those measures are still not enough. That's why from an early stage at the ECLAC, we proposed that, especially in terms of income transfers, guaranteeing a basic emergency basic income for the duration of at least 6 months, because we're seeing at the beginning that countries were only announcing measures for 1 month, now extended but not so at the beginning, and also with very low values, not of sufficient value. So we proposed a basic emergency income with the value equivalent to the poverty line to all the at least to all the people living in poverty in this year. So in the region, it means 37% of the population. Obviously, then you have to see in each country what the possibilities are. And the additional cost of this measure would be 1.9% of GDP. Obviously, we don't look only at the short term. We need to look at the short term and the long term. And the long-term goal from a human rights perspective is obviously to strengthen the welfare state, to promote universal social protection, and also to foster the care economy and introduce a care system. So we also consider that beyond an emergency basic income is key to move gradually towards a universal basic income, obviously within a defined period and gradually in accordance with the circumstances of each country. And we think that sustainable and innovative financing mechanism can be found. Also, we think that given the fact that families with children are poor, a universal child grant is a good idea, is a good stepping stone towards this universal basic income. And obviously, we advise governments to look and take into account the international instruments that are available to strengthen social protection, ILO recommendation 202, obviously also the 2030 agenda, and also in the regional context, the regional agenda for inclusive social development that was adopted by countries in 2019. As I was saying, the situation is dramatic, and this huge crisis means, in poverty terms, this red line, to go back 14 years, because in the early 2000s, the region had made progress in poverty reduction, but unfortunately, we were already the region was already seeing increases in poverty levels, and now a spike. So the debt crisis, what it taught us that we had the setback of 25 years, and that was coupled with wrong policies, with structural adjustment. So our message is not to repeat the mistakes of the past. We say that resources can be found. In human rights, we always talk about the use of maximum available resources. It's not necessarily that countries have those resources in their pockets. For instance, in the region, we see high levels of tax evasion and avoidance, corresponding to about 6.1% of regional GDP. This means three times the amount needed to cover, for instance, the emergency basic income for 6 months. And to boost incomes, thus, we do need to reduce tax evasion. We do need more progressive tax system, also for the richest 1%. We need to reassess the tax incentive that exists, and also think about new taxes on the digital economy, on the environmental harmful activities, tobacco, and other factors related to public health. So in conclusion, what this pandemic has shown are the structural problems of the existing economic model, the shortcomings of social protection systems and welfare regimes. So we do need to rethink the development model. We do need to look with fresh eyes at the Agenda 2030 and to consolidate the environmental, the social, and economic aspects of development and to leave no one behind. We do need to consolidate universal social protection system, which include universal health system, sensitive to differences and rooted in a rights-based approach. Obviously, to reactivate the economy, we do need to think about labor inclusion strategies. We do need to resolve the fragmentation, hierarchization, and commodification of health systems. Basically, as Aline was mentioning, a social compact is needed among all sectors of society, and with this compact focus on well-being and rights. And we say from the ECLAC that it is time for universal, redistributive, and solidarity-based policy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Simone. Your timer was perfect. You finished exactly when my timer rang, so much appreciated. Now we're turning to about 10 minutes of exchange among the panelists before we open up to some of the questions that I'm already seeing on the chat box. So I'm going to turn it back to the panelists and see if you have any burning questions for each other that you can bounce around for now. Do we have Aline back? No, he's not back.
No.
There he is. All right.
Yes, I'm here. Sorry, it's just the technology. I was just curious about what is the virus doing to inequality, and is it a hopeful time, or should we really, feel a bit more pessimistic about whether this is going to really work as a catalyst for big policy change, or is it just going to be the same and we will need to wait for another catastrophe to change things really?
Is it a question or is it a comment, Alim?
It's a question to both of you.
Well, I think I certainly, as in the case of Latin America and the Caribbean, at least, as Simone was pointing out, obviously a situation such as a pandemic like this is going to be exacerbating the existing structural inequalities. And I think, unfortunately, such a terrible and dire situation does provide the space for rethinking not only the social protection scene, our approaches and our responses, but also the larger economic responses. And that clearly indicates the need for fiscal space and finding the fiscal space, and ultimately a change in the social construct as we see it. That's my two cents on that.
And if I may jump in, I agree with Alexandra's point and Aline. Very good question. Unfortunately, in the short term, if we, for instance, look at income inequality or social exclusion, things are getting worse. Because especially in the labor market, those in the informal sector and lower income people are those who are suffering the most. So there is a trend to make things worse in terms of inequality. However, we do need to keep our hopes up and strive for that change of model I was mentioning. And I want to connect here to a question I read on the chat box by Paula Ciclari from Chile. To give you the example of Chile, Chile was already doing not so well before the pandemic. As you all know, there were a huge manifestation and protests because of the dissatisfaction with the model and much also with respect to equality. And there were requests for structural changes. And indeed, it is a time of crisis, say after World War II, then William Beveridge made a huge proposal and we have a universal health in the UK. And then here in Chile as well, people are demanding a more equitable country, more rooted in human rights. They're demanding changes to the pension system, which was privatized. They're demanding more justice in health education. And thus there is hope, there is a process for constitutional change. The Chilean constitution was written during the dictatorship and is not strong in the defense of human rights, especially economic and social cultural rights. So there is that process. There is a chance to have that social compact that we are hoping for. I'm not saying it is easy, but there is a huge window of opportunity. And this is not only the case of Chile. In many countries, this is the time to rethink how we do things, and it's a chance to do things differently.
Thank you, Simone. I think we're going to go to, that was a great segue into some of the questions from the audience. I'm going to group several of them into one heading, and that's on this idea of who bears the responsibility for ensuring and fulfilling these rights. And that question has come up. So who's responsible for social protection? The state, NGOs, families, communities? And then another person has framed the question in a different way, which is, we seem to have we don't have public policies in a lot of low and middle income countries. Instead, we've got government policies. So again, making this distinction and highlighting this, precisely what you're talking about, this lack of accountability or sense of a lack of accountability. And then there's also questions about democracy. What is the role of democracy in all of this? Does this play out differently? Does this accountability and these accountability structures play out differently in democratic versus non-democratic countries? So why don't we talk a bit about accountability and also link to this idea of rights that are stated at high levels often in countries. So at the level of the constitution, there might be either an enabling statement about this responsibility of the state, or there might be something more specific. When does that make a difference? In what kinds of contexts are you more likely to have a realization of rights or for people to be able to demand those rights more effectively? So I'll turn over to you. Is anyone burning to answer that? Would anyone like to go first?
I'm happy to go first.
Yeah.
And then have my colleagues also provide their insights. I mean, I think the short question to that is that the state is responsible, right? There is a right to social protection, social security, and the state is the duty bearer, and there's responsibility. Throwing the responsibility to families, to what some call informal social protection and what have you, exacerbates issues around, for example, gender inequality. It also stresses the whole care aspect. That could be a whole webinar, right? The impact of care and what are the care implications of all of this and what role does it play in social protection? So I think the short response is the state is the responsible actor. And I always like to also think about it this way. When we talk about education, there doesn't seem to be, for example, the question is, whose responsibility is it to ensure universal primary education, for example? Why do we never question some of the other sectors that have already gained some space in terms of either universality or either that the realization that it's actually the state who is responsible for providing some of these other rights or some of these other social services? And I always, there seems to be, again, it always, this issue around the deservingness always comes in terms of who actually deserves this. But ultimately, it is the state's responsibility. And if there are other actors, such as NGOs implementing some social protection schemes or collaborating with the government, that is an option. There's obviously solutions there. But it is, in terms of social protection provision, it's the responsibility of the state. Having said that, there are obviously social protection as a sole sector is not going to solve poverty, inequality, and structural injustices in any of our societies. There's obviously every sector in the economy and in government has a role to play in terms of how we're going to be addressing issues around poverty and inequality, and in particular in the midst of COVID-19, such as employment and what have you. There's many other sectors, as well as the fiscal space, that also need to be involved.
I could follow through. Yes, I think I entirely agree with what you've said, but I think sometimes when we consider the states, there are two aspects of state sovereignty that we don't really fully comprehend. One is that, and this is what I said in my presentation, was that is there a maldevelopment within the nature of state process, state making process? And we know that multi-ethnic states or multinational states have much more difficulty in public policy process because the nature of dialogue is not egalitarian. And this goes back to the discussion on with H. McGlue and the why nations fail, where they talk about the formation of economic and political institutions early in the state formation, which if captured by the elite do not allow the kind of dialogue that needs to happen for policy process to be equal. And I think that distortion when it creeps into state building process is very, very difficult to address. I think the second aspect of this is there is an international financial architectural problem. The what we are now seeing is the collapse of the international capitalist order. There is what we call not an economic crisis, but a crisis of economics. We have unsustainable debt, about $173 trillion of debt globally, which is a big hole that needs to be filled. And the flow of resources still remains in the net terms from development to development. An example of a country, for example, in Pakistan, out of Pakistan's budget, about one third of the budget in Pakistan goes to debt servicing. And while there has been some discussion going on debt relief, I think the situations have already become untenable and unsustainable for many countries in Africa and South Asia. Yes, there may be the reason for that to have occurred is because of what I said were the initial malformation of the state issue, the leadership that we have had. But I think now it has got to the point where unless there is a major and radical change in how international financial architecture is shaped, developing countries will not be able to walk out of that trap. And this is why when we talk about this, we say not just debt forgiveness, but debt relief, but debt forgiveness, capital controls, which have to do with the fact that countries are hemorrhaging economies. There's a dollarization taking place in developing countries because local currencies are losing value, increasing poverty in many areas. So I think there are larger international dimensions at play, which do not allow countries' sovereignties to be fully become operational or to be fully exercised. And that perpetuates a sort of a dynamic that puts in place what we see as a model that states have predominantly. Over to Simon.
Thank you. Yes, well, first of all, connecting to what Aline was just saying, the debt issue is huge, obviously, in Latin America and the Caribbean. From the ECLAC, we have made the call to, for instance, for debt forgiveness for the small Caribbean states who are also traditionally hit by many disasters connected to natural phenomena, but also other countries in the region. Think of Argentina, the need to make debt more sustainable is key to protect the population. And also a comment on the question, Shay, and of the things we're discussing on democracy and on going from governments to state policies. That's key. It is a time that is complicated for democracy, right? Because to face this coronavirus, very often some more authoritarian measures are taken. So we need to be careful about that. But in terms of social protection, we have seen, at least in some cases, that there are avenues to have policies and programs discussed through congresses. Brazil adopted the emergency income via Congress, and it is a very important measure to provide relief to informal workers. And similarly, in Chile, an emergency family income was created, and then it was discussed by the government with the opposition, and finally, in the second version, it was more generous in terms of incomes and in terms of the population to be attended. So there have been processes of trying to go not only from government policies to more state policy.
Okay, that's a good transition to my next group of questions. And I want the audience to please forgive me for not singling out individual questions, but there are common themes running throughout. So I think it's more efficient for us to group them. And this question goes to the gaps between what might be provided legally and what's actually occurring in practice. So sometimes you might have universal or ostensibly universally designed programs, but you don't have access specifically, or especially people internally displaced persons, so especially vulnerable populations, persons with disabilities, etc. So how can we close that gap, and what are the best ways to design policies that ensure or that make it easier to achieve that coverage in practice, that effective coverage? Anyone? It's a broad question.
Yeah. I mean, my first take on that would be that one of the reasons I was sort of pointing to the fact that legal frameworks by themselves, unfortunately, are not necessarily there necessary, but there might not be enough, right? So from a rights-based approach as well, the idea is that we progress towards, and sorry for the repetition of the words, but a progressive realization of the right to social security and social protection. So the idea is that we gradually, and particularly in countries in low and middle income countries, that might not, I saw in one of the comments, the issue around the fiscal space. There is no fiscal space, and within these constraints, in particular in COVID-19, what do we do? So the idea is, from a practical approach, when we provide also recommendations in terms of the advice, is that to start with basic building blocks of an inclusive and life cycle social protection system, so that we start off with some of the but again, instead of starting with fragmented systems that provide just poverty reduction or provide social protection for the poorest of the poor and what have you, is to start from the very start looking at where there is fiscal space and building on inclusive building blocks. In terms of accessibility, I saw that question as well. And in the case, for example, of persons with disabilities or other groups that have been systematically marginalized from public policies and public programs, and in particular social protection, even if they are universal programs, there might be universal in nature or universal in name, by name in terms of the legal framework, there might be issues around accessibility with regards to the way that they are implemented and the way that they are put in practice, let's put it that way, both at the very local level or even state level bureaucrats in terms of how the interface works. And there again, I always try, and at least when we provide recommendations on these, the way that we do that is we have to provide very good operational and regulatory frameworks to be able to sort of fill that gap and make sure that the way that these programs and services are implemented are not in terms of violating particular rights in terms of accessibility, for example, in terms of dignity. So that's one of the recommendations or yes, advices that we should provide.
Just another angle on this, I think, is the fact that we may have to think differently in terms of who else could actually come in and step in into the vacuum for universality. And in particular, in South Asia and Middle East, there are countries who have actually formalized an Islamic injunction for what they call zakat, which has been used, which is a voluntary contribution that people make to either the government or a non-government process, which is used then as a fund to help the poor people. Sometimes I ask myself, why is it that there are not many deaths due to starvation in South Asia, where you do have such low coverage of social protection? And partly that is because there is a very large informal social protection mechanism that operates within South Asia in terms of extended families, extended neighborhoods, and people help each other out. And I think there's a large part of GDP that is hidden because of informal economies. And the question is, can the government can play a facilitative role to try and formalize that process without intimidating people to be able to improve the coverage of social protection? The same goes for private sector, where there's lip service paid by the private sector in terms of corporate social responsibility. But I think that there is a need for sensitizing the corporate sector for public service, because the public service has been privatized. And there needs to be some sort of a balance between those two forces to be able to create a dynamic that helps people.
And on my side, well, first of all, I'd like to stress the fact that when we think about universality, we need to think about population coverage, which is be as broad as possible, but also about the sufficiency of the entitlements that we are providing, and also at their financial sustainability. So we need to have an integral view of that. And also in Latin America, at the ECLAC, we have pushed a lot for the concept of universality, which is sensitive to differences, which means obviously we need common ground, but also we need to recognize the specificities, say, rural populations or indigenous or Afro descendants, they need to be attended, or people with disabilities, they need some specific ways to be attended. And also a comment I have is on the more rights being based on legislation. Sometimes legislation can be some unjust. Right, there can be entitlements, say, to very generous pensions for very specific population groups. Thus, we need to remit once again to the concepts of citizenships and social pacts. The fact that in the face of this great crisis, at least in our region, this is a crisis of historical proportion, but for the world over, we need to get together and see, okay, this is hitting us all over, we are on the same boat, we need to think about a more just social protection system.
Thank you, Simone. I want to ask about the issue of care, and part of what you said it reminded me of one of the questions, that social protection is often weighted toward the income transfer side, but also in your presentation, you presented in some of the responses that have been in-kind benefits as well. But I did notice that, care has been essentially absent from our discussion and from your interventions today. And I would say that's not uncommon in our field. And in some countries, certainly, social care is defined as a central pillar in the social protection system. That's not always the case, so I don't want to get into a debate about definitions of social protection, but let's acknowledge that social care in every country plays a key role, complementary role with the social protection system, and certainly in a post-pandemic or in the middle of a pandemic as we find ourselves now. So what are countries doing and what can they do to strengthen those linkages between the social care system and the social transfer system?
We go in the same order or? Okay, well, just, I think it's great the question you're posing, because indeed, We mentioned it very briefly, but what we are saying is that the care economy needs to be considered in a much more deep way than so far, because as I was saying, if we see how we are facing these crises and all the unpaid the non-remunerated work that is done mostly by women for cultural reasons in our region, and also all the care that is needed in a health crisis, but also if we look in longer terms, the population in our region is getting older, and the issue of care always comes up. And there is need to make this issue more visible, because when we think about GDP and incomes, etc., care gets out of the discussion because it's not measured in the national accounts. So it's a matter of making it more visible statistically and making it more visible in policy terms, as you were saying, Shay, there are discussions about the inclusion of social care and the relationship with social protection. At the ECLAC, increasingly, we see social care as one of the pillars of social protection. And in the region, there are some examples of countries that have made strides in that sense. There is a social care system formally in Uruguay, and also Costa Rica has made progress. So examples exist, and by chance, or maybe not by chance, those countries that I mentioned, Costa Rica, Uruguay, are the countries that are more advanced in terms of social protection, the welfare state, and guess what, also some of the countries that have had better results in terms of the impacts of the coronavirus on the population. Over.
If I can add to what Simona was saying also, I mean, not necessarily from a Latin American perspective, but I definitely think that the whole issue around the care economy and social care and care as a very important construct in society is absolutely key to be looked at and addressed from a gender equity aspect as well. And I would also say that I think this discussion is not only valid for low and middle income countries, but also what we call high income countries, in the sense that this virus, for example, has very much put to test some of the social care, existing social care, and some of the gaps existing in high income countries, such as the United States or the UK or other European countries. So it's necessary, I think it's definitely something that we many times forget to mention, or we many times leave out of the picture, but it is a core aspect of an inclusive social protection system, for sure.
Yeah, I'll skip. I think it's been comprehensively answered.
Okay, thank you. I've just been told that we can continue. Maybe two, three more minutes. So there have been some specific questions added that I might, maybe we can return to this last question on the list that's about shock responsiveness, because that was mentioned in Alex's presentation, but in fact, that's sort of the overriding theme of a pandemic response, isn't it? How well do social protection systems respond in times of crisis, more generally, but specifically in this crisis? So which types of systems are more shock responsive? And Alexandra pointed to inclusive life cycle social protection systems that have broader coverage would be most able to respond. And I guess my question would be about that life cycle approach. One of the things that we seem to see is that one of the areas or stages of the life cycle that is most sparsely covered is working age. So we tend to have easy solutions in the form of child benefits, conventional child benefits for children. We have old age pensions. We know how to do that. There are models we can follow. In working age, it gets a bit murkier. We've got short-term benefits, we've got unemployment, we've got, you know, maternity, sickness, etc. But those are usually not intended to cover for a long-term period. So you wouldn't be able to scale them up in the same way. And in fact, countries have been struggling with this precisely in this moment. So unemployment systems where they do exist have not been sufficient and have had to be bolstered, don't cover the informal economy, which has been most severely affected by the crisis. So what are these solutions to shock responsiveness? What are the best practices that you've been able to identify in the regions that you cover, for specifically for working age? But you can also, I'll allow you to talk about child benefits as well.
Just before we get into the regional, just to add, I mean, to add on to what I had already said, in the sense that inclusive life cycle and social protection systems, because they cover larger public, I mean, areas of segments of the population, they tend to be more effective as well in terms of being able to cover in terms of the shock responsiveness component. So that was basically the comment on that in terms of the shock responsiveness. Now, having said that, one, I suppose, frame that we should add to your question, Shay, is that both regions that we're talking about today as well in particular, they're both regions in which we have a very large percentage of the working force in the informal sector. And I think that is one of the main gaps, because the social protection sector has been in many cases provision has been fragmented between the contributory and the non-contributory side. The way that we move forward, I think that's the main gap, right? I'm not giving you the response in terms of the policy response, but that the response needs to take into consideration this fact, right, that we have this fragmented service provision. So one of the arguments that we've been trying to push since the beginning of this crisis as well is, let's not continue with that fragmentation by adding on cash transfers and different services that are only addressing those temporary need of the informal workers and this and that, because that's just helping ever so more to the fragmentation of the social protection provision. And I'll hand over to my colleagues so they can provide the region.
Yeah, I must say that in two countries that I have been in where disasters struck, not a fault of mine, we ran from UNICEF side two very large income cash transfer programs running into millions of dollars. And they were both very successful because they were piggybacked on existing targeted interventions run by the governments. So when we came in, there was already a platform available, and what really happened was a horizontal and a vertical expansion of the existing targeting process and reaching those people very quickly. So I think there is this positive side of those kinds of programs. But the problem with this is the fact that you never know where the disaster is going to strike. So you sometimes tend to focus, and these are either geographically focused or population-based focused programs. In this case, for instance, now COVID points out that nobody is safe until everybody is safe. And therefore, the whole argument whether targeted programs, when they are faced with sudden rush of help, do become successful, because they can actually deliver very quickly. Pakistan's Ehsaas program covered 16 million households in 2-3 months, and it's being held up as a successful example. But the problem is, we don't know when and where the next disaster is going to strike. And so you have to build the universal inclusive social protection systems so that you have a single registry, not a social registry, where everybody is able to access in the short term help by the government, covering in fact the informal sector, including the informal sector, so that they become really shock responsive.
Yes, and indeed the best shock responsive social protection is universal right-based social protection systems, right, rather than fragmented programs. What we have seen in Latin America indeed is what you were mentioning, Shi, that there is a void. It is informal workers. Traditionally, Latin American social protection systems were modeled on the Bismarckian model. They were created for more urban, formal male workers, with the exclusion of the rural workers, indigenous people, etc. And what we saw now, we saw two changes. One was during the period of expansion of conditional cash transfer programs that were addressed, especially they started in rural areas, and those they started covering broad sectors of the population. In the end, even if they were targeted, they ended up covering about 1/5 of the regional population. But then now we have another challenge, which is coronavirus strikes, and workers are not able to produce and to go out to work, and thus the informal who are not covered, they need to be protected. And this has been at the center of the discussion. Many of the programs launched, I was mentioning the one in Brazil, but also Argentina, Chile, they were thought indeed to reach the informal workers, for instance, by using both the social registries and crossing out information to see if there were no formal incomes, and thus there has been a new wave. Now, in the recovery period, we will see this is a very much a discussion rooted in national circumstances, but as I was saying, the idea of a universal basic income is a good one, and since it is to be implemented gradually, and luckily even the Secretary General report launched last week mentioned that universal child grants are a good idea, because families very often with parents who are informal workers, families with children are among those who are suffering the.
I think that's a good note to leave it on. We've gone over time, so I'm afraid we won't be able to answer all of the questions. I do want to redirect you to the online community. So if you haven't registered already on socialprotection.org, then please do join the online community where you can stay updated about future webinars, as we mentioned in the beginning, but also specifically debates that have been covered in this webinar, including all of the links that have been made available in the chat. They'll be recorded in that space. So once you're in the online community, you can access all of those resources, including written pieces by our panelists and their respective organizations. There was one question I didn't get to, and I'm not going to let you answer it. I'm just going to leave it as food for thought, because it was asking about what is the role of the UN in all of this, and is there a unified front in all of this? So I think it would have been an interesting question to take. I'm sad we didn't get to it, and I want to leave you with that challenge, you representatives of different UN organizations, to speak with one voice. And I hear some promising things coming out that Simone mentioned, and that I believe are in the resources as well. So I think we'll close. And thank you all again for joining us today. I think our numbers are rapidly diminishing as people have been signing out as we've gone over time. So thank you all, thank you to the panelists, and we look forward to reuniting in another virtual space in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
See you all. Bye.
Bye-bye. A pleasure.